Hi, everyone. I'm Barbara Beck, and I want to thank you for tuning in to Welcome Home. Our program today is so important because it involves a huge segment of our population right here in Central Florida. Those who work for a living, and I mean really work hard at several jobs, but are still at the poverty level. Part of the problem is that there are so many people who work for minimum wage who are heads of their households, and oftentimes that's just not enough to get by. So we're going to be talking to Eric Gray from United Against Poverty, known as Up Orlando, and hear how maybe we can help with this downtown ministry that serves hundreds of people every day. And then he's brought a couple of people who have been benefited from Up Orlando, and we'll hear their compelling stories. But before we get to that part of our program, let's see what the current ladies have to say about what we call the working poor. Hello, ladies.
Hello. Hello.
Welcome.
Hi,
anybody working poor on this panel?
There are those days,
but we understand what working poor is, and these people are really, really having a hard time. 2 in 3 jobs. Have you ever been in that situation? Anybody on the panel?
I think at one season in our life, we've all been where, you know, there's still more month left than there is money in the bank account. And, you know, I think everybody goes through seasons of stretching, but, you know, sometimes it's that feeling of hopelessness. Not everybody's fortunate to have family members or friends or to be plugged into a church or a fellowship that we help one another get through those kind of dry seasons and times. But I wanted to just encourage our viewers that there's tools and resources and things out there. I mean, Carol and I went to a CEO Chick event not too long ago, and there was a lady by the name of Tila Wheeler that spoke. And, you know, very accomplished woman. She's an attorney. She helps raise millions of dollars for not-for-profit organizations for celebs. But at one point, she was trying to get herself through law school, and she was raising all these children, and she was struggling to make ends meet. And so, you know, sometimes the Bible says we perish for the lack of knowledge. So when you're hungry enough, you'll start finding ways to make extra money. And she gave some great resources and tips, even at home doing online surveys. Or there's a place here locally called Consumer Connections where they will pay you for your opinion. So I think if we just encourage our sisters in Christ or give people the resources, like, there's stuff you can do to make an extra $20. And sometimes that's all you need to get a little bit more groceries to make it through the end of the month, or pay for an activity or sport that your kid is in as well.
And that was so eye-opening that day. It truly was. She was saying that there are some of these, and we really should make it available somewhere online.
We'll do it on our Facebook page.
For people, because you're sitting at home and all they want is your opinion. Mm-hmm. She said one place she got a $250 check just for giving her survey.
Yeah, let us know.
I know. Some shopping money or whatever.
Well, we all have opinions, you know, whether they're right or wrong. That's great.
I know. I mean, there was, and she gave a lot that day.
That's good.
It really encouraged, because a lot of those women are trying to start their own businesses and such, and really struggling, as most people do, working 2 and 3 jobs and trying to take care of families and children. And, you know, my heart goes out to
it. And there are single parents out there that is probably the norm for them,
to be
working poor maybe for the rest of their lives. I mean, Deborah, you were a single parent for a while, right?
I was a single parent.
Yeah.
Never worked 2 or 3 jobs, though. I was always blessed to have an 8 to 5 Monday through Friday job. Mm-hmm. But as a single parent, my income was always more than enough to get food stamps. I was always a little bit above that line. And then there weren't as many resources back then as there are now. Mm-hmm. And so I was always worried that I was going to barely make it. Mm-hmm. And all glory goes to God, because I made it. Mm-hmm. But especially for a single parent, that is always a difficult place.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, I actually, a girl that works with me, she had food stamps, and then we gave her a raise, and then she wasn't able to get food stamps anymore. And it really upset me, because I'm like, wait a second, she's being penalized almost, you know, for now making more money. But we all, you know, came around her, and now she's making more and she's going back to school, but it is tough. I am always checking in on her and her kids and how it's going, because I was just shocked that here you are thinking you're doing something right? And then all of a sudden, by getting a raise, she went backwards.
Right. And probably the raise that she received really wasn't enough for her to be able to do all that she needed to do for her family.
Right.
And so now she's losing this benefit that was there for her and her children.
And for she lost that too.
It puts you in a very difficult position especially as a single parent.
So what's the solution, Deborah? Is there anything, or Leanne, what do you think we can do?
Well, I think from a governmental standpoint, mm-hmm. I think the levels need to be raised a little bit.
And you're talking about minimum wage.
Yeah, well, minimum wage, but also when you start talking about resources like food stamps mm-hmm. and 4C and things like that, they probably need to broaden their application yeah. process mm-hmm. to make certain allowances and considerations for specific people.
And it shouldn't be an all or nothing, right?
Right.
I thought that they should do a sliding scale.
Right, right. And even being able to get into some government subsidized housing, mm-hmm. all of those things have limits that are just so definite, and there's no consideration for the individual situation or circumstances.
So what, mm-hmm. talk to our legislators? I mean, do we get politically involved or write letters? Or, you know, I mean, I don't know a lot about this, and I'm sure there are viewers out there today listening that are not recognizing that, you know, we think poor people, we think homeless people, but these are not homeless people. These are people who are working really, really hard. So what do we do?
And they're not all uneducated either.
Right. That's right.
Let
That's
me just
right.
say that because yes. we have so many that are going to school, they're getting a mm-hmm. degree,
yep.
you graduate from college, and now you can't get a job in your area
exactly.
of specialty, and now you're forced to take a job. You know, you went to school for something that was going to pay you $60,000, $70,000 mm-hmm. a year, but now you're forced to take a job that is paying considerably less.
Yeah.
So it's not always, education is not always the mm-hmm. key either.
Or work ethic.
So, right.
Oftentimes people are working so hard and they have a great work ethic, they just can't get over that hump
right.
to allow them into a job that would pay a higher income to keep that wheel.
Or they have a lot of children. I had a friend with a ton of children, and both parents were working, and she asked me about Community Food and Outreach, which is now up Orlando.
Right.
And she said, do you think I would qualify? And I said, well, you know, good for you for at least looking into it. Go to them, see, to fill out an application, because the groceries that you buy at Up Orlando are drastically reduced in price. They're mm-hmm. they're not giving the hand out. They are giving a hand up to
yeah.
people who are really working and that need that temporary kind of assistance. It's not something that has to last a lifetime, just a little bit of assistance.
And I come back to, I love that scripture in Galatians. It says that we are to bear ye one another's burdens.
Yes. Yeah.
And to me, I mean, we grew up very, very poor. I mean, I remember growing up that if we wanted a $5 pizza, that was our big deal on Friday nights.
Mm-hmm.
We were digging our hands down in all the couches and the mm-hmm. car seats mm-hmm. and everything, trying to get any coins that anybody had dropped just to go pay
yeah.
for that pizza with coins. And it's so important as us as Christians. I just keep coming back to it because it's our responsibility. I feel like we give the government way too much, mm. I want to call it too much control or too much responsibility of something that's my responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
You're my sister, you're my brother, and I need to ask the church, I need to step up and take my place. I mean, it says, and so fulfill the law of mm-hmm. Christ. This is mm-hmm. our responsibility
mm-hmm.
to begin to reach out when we see people in need. You know, why don't we take a bag of groceries over? I remember people used to do that for us growing up. We didn't have food. We would pray, God, please help us. Somebody would come and say, God spoke to us and said we were supposed to bring you this bag of food.
Yeah. Well,
I mean,
and I'll add to that, if you're a business owner, my husband and I own a business and I own a business, you need to pay your people well. We pay well over minimum wage, and even for what we do, we then pay more. It just, you've got to take responsibility if you're able to.
Yeah, and what is the church's responsibility, like you just said? I know that First Baptist has been really good about helping support Up Orlando.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we are in a position as the church, we are the church, individuals
right.
are the church, but also the building of the church, those people need to be helping to support some of these people.
I think it's a call to action with anything. I mean, there are organizations in place, but if you go to these organizations,
yeah.
they're like, we don't have enough, we need help. So I think it's about educating the body of Christ and letting them know, these are the statistics, this is the need in our own community. Do your part. That doesn't mean you have to do everything, but if everybody just did their part,
right.
none of us should be lacking anything in our community.
So what is your part? What is your part to
your
do?
Your part I is to get the red bag and
okay.
fill it with groceries.
And
I mean,
to
we
pay
have
your
that
people.
At church.
If
yeah,
you're
pay
a business
well.
Owner, pay your people.
Yeah.
Well. Don't
yeah.
take it all for yourselves.
How about volunteering? Volunteering at some of these places, right? With our children?
Totally. I think it is such a combined effort.
Yes.
I think
yeah.
there's a real role for government.
Mm-hmm.
There's a real role for individual responsibility.
Right.
There's a real role for the church to
that's
be responsible as well.
Right. That's a good point.
You know, there are so many programs that people really benefit from, And there's a real responsibility on ourselves to not take advantage of programs that
that's
we don't need.
That's a good point, too. That's a whole
that we don't need help from. Mm-hmm. Because it's taking away from the people who are being responsible and really need
help. So you think
help.
There's some of those people out there who are taking advantage of the system?
Absolutely. There's people that know how to work the system.
But I think they're
just asking the question.
Well, it's true. That's a great question because there are people that do that.
And I say this in defense of the church. It is very difficult as a church to be able to meet every need
it
that
is,
a person
right.
has.
And you know
it is
from firsthand, right?
I know firsthand. And so, again, one of the things that we've done is we've vetted organizations mm-hmm. that are out there that are doing the work. And, for instance, Second Harvest Food Bank, mm-hmm. it's easier for them to connect to another not-for-profit organization, and they get the food from them for pennies, mm-hmm. okay? Mm-hmm. The church is not going to do that.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Sure.
And
mm-hmm.
so we connect to somebody, and then when people come to us, we're able to say, we're not going to give you $75 mm-hmm. for food, but you can go to this organization. Mm-hmm. There was a time, Barbara, when we kept gift cards and we were giving out gift cards. Kristen, we saw the same people mm-hmm. all the time. Mm-hmm. And so instead of us vetting and making sure that people aren't taking advantage of the resources, we send them to organizations that have everything in mm-hmm. place to be able to do that. So that means the people that are in the pews, we have to be givers.
Yeah.
We have to be givers. We have to be committed to tithing.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
We have to be committed to giving in the benevolence offerings so that the resources are in the churches to be able to help support those organizations mm-hmm. that are on the front line, that are doing the work, so that the churches are not strapped with trying to meet every single need.
Well, and I think it's, well, I love what we're all saying because it's so true. I think if we all get involved, it's leaving our own comfort zones. Mm-hmm. I don't mean this wrong, to get involved in other people's lives when ours can seem so overwhelming, can mm-hmm. seem like a lot. But if you get involved in somebody's life, you can say, what is your real need? Instead of people coming and taking advantage of the system and taking from the other people who really need it, you're involved and you can give them that hand up and saying, you know what, today you might need some encouragement, that here's the day that you can get out and go get another job or a better job. You're not just what you think you are, because sometimes their mm-hmm. self-esteem's so low, they just need some encouragement. So I think it's that personal involvement in people's lives that you can go to really what the need is and what the struggle is and be a problem solver.
The problem mm-hmm. to me with that, and I think that is an incredibly great point, Carolyn, is how do we get into those other circles of, and that's what we've done, a racial reconciliation show that has been such a powerful show, mm-hmm. and what the black and the white and the Hispanic and the yellow, all the communities want is for us to be involved in each other's lives. Mm-hmm. But how do we do that? There can be no reconciliation, no helping all these other people unless we get out there and we do it. So practically speaking, how do we do that?
It's being intentional in relationship. I think that's the key. How do you build that bridge? You have to make an effort. You have to be consistent. You have to be authentic and genuine in your motives. And it takes time. I don't think any of these things we're talking about, these issues that we address, are something you can just strike a match and it's addressed, Amen. It's done, everything is fine. I mean, the word says, in this world, you're going to have trouble, but be a good cheer. I've overcome the world. So we have to be a part of the long-term solution, and we have to be intentional about building authentic relationships with one another and not just going, oh, hey, how are you doing? And you're zipping
exactly.
by while you're asking that question.
Exactly.
How are you doing? And giving somebody an opportunity to respond so then we can engage and start being a part of the solution.
So God does his part, that's for sure.
Right.
We need to do our part. I hope today, viewers, that you've been encouraged to do your part to help minister to the working poor. Who are they? They may be the person that's right next door to you or the person who is sitting in the pew next to you in church, or it may be in another church. We just need to get involved. We've got more with Eric Gray coming up to talking about the working poor, so stay with us. Thanks so much for joining us today on Welcome Home. You know, we've been talking about the working poor, who they are, what their role is in our society, why there's so many working poor in the area. Well, we have an expert on that with us here today. Eric Gray is the Director of Community Food and Outreach, which is the old name for the new name, Up Orlando. And I'm so honored and privileged to have you here with us today, Eric. Welcome.
It's a treat being here. Thank you.
So you are, did I say that right? You're the director. Is that what your title is?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yeah, executive director, but it couldn't be less important.
Director.
I'm just a staff member like anybody else, trash and picking up food and whatever it needs to be.
Well, I know you get to do all of that. I've been there before. It's on Michigan Street. It's a wonderful organization. You're serving so many in our community. First of all, Eric, tell us who the working poor are.
Well, there's no one generally accepted definition, but what we typically follow in our line of thinking is that anybody in the United States that is earning a household income of less than 200% of the U.S. poverty level, or twice the U.S. poverty level, mm-hmm. would be considered the working poor. And roughly for a family of four earning about $44,000 a year or less as a household, that would put you in that bracket. Mm-hmm. Being in that bracket typically qualifies you for some type of minor assistance. You have to get pretty far down to really qualify for serious assistance. Mm-hmm. Some people classify working poor as people earning under $25,000 a year. And in Orlando, for that statistic, there are 37% of all workers in the Orange, Seminole, Osceola County area, of which there's about 1.2 million working adults, about 37%.
37%. That is amazing.
It really is, and it's really hard to wrap your mind around,
yes.
and we are by far the largest percentage of population at that income level of any community in the United States. Mm-hmm. There's a whole number of distinctions that we hold the number one slot in, and many that we just don't really want to wave the foam finger around and talk about. Mm-hmm. Of course, the number one tourist destination in the world, literally the most popular place on the planet, and that's great, and we love talking about it. But there's some other things that we really want to be talking about, especially amongst family here,
you know,
that we need to talk about some of our problems as well.
Is part of the problem the fact that we are the number one tourist destination? We have so many people working at minimum wage?
Well, I think that it certainly contributes that we have the second highest percentage of adults working in the service sector behind Las Vegas.
Okay.
But when you look at the 22 different job categories that the Department of Labor measures, like agriculture or finance or service, we're actually the lowest wage community in 21 of those 22 job categories. So it's not just the tourism sector, it's pretty much across the board in the Orlando area. And it's not particularly unique to Orlando. This is really the same in the Tampa and Miami area as well. But Orlando has the distinction of being the lowest wage community in the United States of the top 50 major U.S. markets. And it's a big problem that we don't really like to talk about hand in hand with the really popular parts of the community. And it's totally understandable. It's not exactly the Chamber of Commerce pitch that we want out there.
Sure.
But as I always say to folks, denial is not a good thing. We really want to make sure that we're talking about all aspects, especially when it's just us, and it's just people that live here in this community. We need to talk about everything.
And you see hundreds of people come across your doorstep every single day there at Up Orlando. And I know a lot of times we get kind of hung up on the homeless population, and there are so many homeless people in Orlando. But the working poor sometimes get neglected because of all the emphasis and spotlight on the homeless people. But hundreds and hundreds of people, tell us who you serve.
We average around 520 people a day, 7 days a week. We're only closed about 5 days a year, and it's constant. Not only do we have a large number of people coming every day, but we have an increasing number of people who register for the program, which is totally free, but you have to meet that income requirement of being 200% of the U.S. poverty level and below. But that's 44% of the community. Again, the largest percentage in the country. Mm. So even though there are a large number of people, 2.5 million people in this community, Orange, Seminole, Osceola County, 44% of them would qualify for our program. We're serving a measurable percentage. We have about 23,000 members, but it's still just a fraction of the larger community that's really struggling to make ends meet. And there's nothing better or worse about being above the U.S. poverty level or below. There's nothing magical about that statistic. Mm-hmm. It's just a measure of trying to gauge, compared to other communities, how are we doing? And right now, compared to other communities, we're not doing very well.
What does Orlando do to serve the working poor? What kind of things do you have for them?
So when we started off a decade and a half ago, it was just a grocery program that was really an alternative to a traditional food pantry. And there's nothing wrong with food pantries. Many people need them. Sure. A lot of churches offer them. Mm-hmm. But when you're using emergency food assistance for multiple years and sometimes multiple generations, it's no longer an emergency. So some really smart people got together and put this model in place such that there's a two-way exchange and this idea of offering a hand up as opposed to a handout, which is not unique to us, but we just do it in a slightly different way. So the food program, the grocery program, has been around for a long time, but we've added to that over the years by partnering with other agencies on our property in downtown Orlando. We have a healthcare clinic, which is run by the Healthcare Center for the Homeless, domestic abuse counseling, which is run by Harbor House. We work a lot with Aspire Health on mental health and substance abuse issues, the Department of Children and Families, the Orange County Public School System, the University of Florida Agriculture Extension Office. So multiple different agencies, about 27, that do some work on our property at some level to offer whatever assistance you can to folks who fall under that threshold of 200% of U.S. poverty or the working poor.
So what is the greatest need, Eric, that you've seen in our community?
Well, it may sound overly simplistic, but it really is awareness. I think that there's I go out and speak constantly to different Rotary clubs and school groups and anybody who will listen. And I'm still amazed, not just amongst the general public, but amongst the elected leaders, business leaders, and in some cases faith leaders, although they seem to have a better understanding than most, that there's just a lack of awareness of the magnitude of the issue in this community. And I don't blame them because it's hard to wrap your mind around this problem.
It is.
444,078 people living in poverty in this community, Orange, Seminole, Osceola County, in 2015. You could do all kinds of comparisons with how many football fields that would fill up and such, but it is a gigantic number of people that are really struggling every single day here.
Well, if you just drive by the facility on Michigan and you see people standing in line to get in, I mean, it's a heartbreaking thing because these, Eric, as you know better than I know, these are people who are working hard. They're working for a living, but they can't make ends meet. And it's not, I mean, what is the profile of the person? It's not necessarily the mentally ill person. What makes a person get to that position? Is it health issues? Is it, what is it?
Sure. I think that, unfortunately, because it's such a large body of people, it really could be anything.
Yeah.
Some of the more common things that we see for folks who are in a really bad place would be lack of family support in the community. There's nobody to fall back on. They just don't have any family to say, hey, can you help me out with this? Some people, it's a domestic abuse situation, and that's far more prevalent than anyone's really wanting to talk about. And other times, it's just bad luck, you know, loss of a job and an illness that struck and just that one thing that you needed that extra couple hundred dollars for and you just don't have it. And now all of a sudden you're falling behind and you're on credit card debt. And unfortunately, this is all too common problem for way too many people, not just in Orlando, but across the entire country. And so people just need a little bit of extra hand up, but we try to offer it in as many different ways as we possibly can, but there's so many different situations, it's hard to say there's one reason.
And what I love, Eric, about what you all do at Up Orlando is you're about sustainability. You're not about the handout, which a lot of times people don't really understand what we're talking about, but you're not just a temporary fix or a Band-Aid. You're trying to get these people to be able to have a sustainable life with an income that's going to take care of their families and a lifestyle that's going to lead them to a victorious life. So I guess my question is, because I know our viewers are going to be excited to hear that we have a couple coming today to talk to us about their experience there at Up Orlando. There's a program called STEP, S-T-E-P. Can you walk us through that? Because this couple is going through that right now.
Sure. The STEP program is newer for us. We've been offering this as an organization for about a year and a half, and it stands for Success Training Employment Program. The name isn't that important. What is important is the process that we go through. So we've researched a lot of programs around the country that are helping people lift themselves out of poverty. And we do workplace skills, help them get job certifications through some of our programs. We help talk about employability and job acquisition and how to write a resume. But I think the most important aspect, and this has been learned through trial and error, is that you have to give people the space to stop and think about where they're at emotionally. Where are they at as a person? And really process the past that's really has influenced how they've gotten there, the current state of affairs, and where you want to go in the future. And if you think about it, most of us don't really stop and think. Some people do. They stop for daily reflection or daily prayer. Some people have a person they can speak with.
Sure.
But I think most of us don't stop and think. And when you're in a really bad place, you know, this program offers that extra helping hand so you stop and think about where you're at. in a support group type of setting amongst people who are good at what they do of leading this type of discussion. So the emotional empowerment component of what we do, I think, is the most important. Mm-hmm. But from there, we're helping people get into internships and on-the-job training or vocational training. Good. And then ultimately, the goal is to get people on living wage jobs.
Right.
So we're not really just interested in the training. We're trying to get people into jobs. This is not a job placement service, but it is just as close as you're going to get, because we work with you until you're in a living wage job, and we don't stop until that happens.
Well, let's see an example of a couple who have been through STEP, or actually they're going through it right now. They're here to tell their story, so I know you don't want to go away. Eric Gray is here with us from Up Orlando, as well as this wonderful couple. So we'll be right back. Stay with us. We've been talking to Eric Gray from what used to be Community Food and Outreach Center in Orlando, which is now Up Orlando. And Eric's been explaining to us who the working poor are and what we can even do as a community to come alongside these people. Well, and speaking of those people, we have two wonderful people from Up Orlando who are here today to tell us a little bit about your story. So Daniel Mayfield and Jonna Williamson, thank you so much for being here with us today.
Thank you for having us, Barbara.
Well, we're glad that you're here. And now you all, we were talking about STEP. Eric, one more time, STEP stands for what?
Success Training Employment Program.
Success Training Employment Program. So you all are in a program that's going to get you out there successful, sustainable. Are you enjoying the program, first of all? Jonna, tell me about how you feel about STEP.
I'm enjoying it very much, and it's helping me to learn about my emotional intelligence, and
good.
To make a resume and write a cover letter so I'll be able to get a job.
What kind of job, Jonna, do you think you want one day?
Well, right now I'm looking for a job as a prep cook.
Okay.
And I've already gone to another program that was called Serve Safe. Mm-hmm. And then I want to go to another program after this.
That's good for you.
Culinary arts training.
Listen to you.
And
very good.
Second Harvest.
Well, one of the best things I think that we can do is to have goals and realize what our purpose is in life. And so when we have that, then we have some direction. So I'm proud mm-hmm. of you for doing that. That's great. Good job. And STEP for you, Daniel. How are you enjoying it?
Oh, I love it. Before getting into STEP, I spent a number of years of my life on the street. I was homeless. I had been incarcerated before. And trying to seek means of self-improvement, I had went to a few programs, and just the emphasis on getting the person inside right
yes.
before trying to go out and deal with the fear of people being professional has really been profound for me.
Yeah.
It's the emphasis on emotional intelligence has really been helpful, not just as far as getting my mind prepared to really start training for a career, but also in my private life as well.
Sure. So Daniel, what are you thinking that you want to do when you get through? What kind of a job are you looking at?
Oh, well, actually, what I intend to dedicate my life to is doing social work.
Good.
I mean, it's a necessity. There is so many people out there that have been through the same things that I've been through, and I want to be able to help them, achieve the best life that they can have.
Well, people need that. We need role models. We need, and people will listen to you, Daniel, where they might not to me, because I've not been homeless. I've not been on the street. Because you have, you're more relatable to that person. So I'm just, I applaud you for that and commend you for that. Plus, you're really articulate. You've got some real communication skills going there. So know that and use that, which I know that you will. I think that's wonderful. What our viewers need to know about the two of you is there's a little love story going on. Right?
Oh, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, Daniel starts smiling real big.
Yeah. Meeting Jonna honestly has changed my life. I'm so glad that God placed her in my path, because without her, there would have been no catalyst for me to try and really start improving myself. I had a really bad substance abuse problem. Mm. I had strong feelings of self-doubt. I had no sense of self-worth at all. Mm-hmm. And meeting Jonna just totally changed that for me, knowing that there was somebody out there that actually saw some value in me.
She really believes in you, yeah, right? And you believe in her.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So, Jonna, were you homeless as well?
Yeah, I was homeless for about 4 years.
Wow. Does that mean on the streets, or were you in a tent somewhere?
I lived under the bridge off of Route 4.
What put you there?
Well, when I first came here to Orlando, I came to semi-retire, and I got carjacked. Mm. And, you know, I lost everything, even though I went to court and the perpetrators got put in jail. They were supposed to pay me restitution, but, you know, I never... You know, they're in jail, they can't.
Yeah.
And I mean, although the police, you know, did take a report and everything, there's really nothing they could do to help me.
Mm-hmm. How did you feel when you were living on the streets?
Well, after a while, I got used to it. And, you know, you just take one day at a time. Mm-hmm. But you get stuck in a rut where, you know, you can't. There's no way out. But, you know, we met this man from the Hope Team.
Yeah.
And, Joel Miller, and what is the name of it?
Permanent Supportive Housing Program. It's sponsored by the Healthcare Center for the Homeless.
That's great.
And the people there are caseworker Deanna Sanchez, our peer support specialist Alvin Colbert. These people have helped us go from literally we were. Like me, before I met John, I was sleeping behind dumpsters, sleeping in sheds, sleeping in abandoned houses, to whereas now both of us have apartments, and they've really been encouraging us to, you know, take advantage of educational opportunities. Good. For self-improvement, so that, you know, we can become the best people that we can be, you know, the best uses. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. So how did you end up at Up Orlando? Did you just happen upon it or walk there or what happened?
Oh, well, actually, Jonna was familiar with the center. She used to go there when it was the community outreach center. And
for your groceries.
For groceries. Mm-hmm. And our case manager, Deanna Sanchez, she had heard about the program and encouraged us to attend. And I'll admit, I was a little skeptical. But upon attending the orientation where, you know, Eric and our program director, Carla Cox, you know, were so eloquent. And from the time that they outlined what the program was about, I knew it was going to be something different and was going to be something that would really
change your life. Well, I see, Eric, that you brought two of your star pupils with you here today. They're amazing.
Well, and... You know, not everybody's willing to speak about their personal experiences, and you know, they really appreciate them being willing to do that because I know others will benefit from the discussion. Right. I think one of the things that is so fascinating is they're among the first success stories of this new movement in the community to help fight chronic homelessness, which is the Permanently Supportive Housing Program that the Commission on Homelessness and my predecessor, Andre Bailey, has really pushed for. And this idea that it's actually more effective in the community to push on a housing first model as opposed to, you know, paying for people to use the emergency rooms and maybe be incarcerated, you know, because that's the only place people can get a shelter over their head. And I think that our goal here is we're just starting with, you know, Jonna and with Daniel. It's just the beginning, you know, for this program. And we have years of working with these guys, but it's really, we're not doing that much for them. We're providing a place for them to come together and talk to other people and just provide some counseling along the way. They really, you know, and this whole process really have to do for themselves, which is what they exactly want to do. And just the idea of being able to take that time to stop and think, speak with others, get some idea of what your options are, and just keep taking one step at a time. And sometimes that's all you need, that little extra support. And if you don't have family support,
right,
this is hopefully we're helping provide
a
little
bit of that. You are their community. You know, we all need community. We need people around us to speak truth into our lives, to believe in us, like you were talking about so eloquently, Daniel. And when we have that, then we have some direction in life. You don't feel like you're all alone. I do want to ask you one really personal question, because I rarely get to talk to somebody as personally as we do that has been in a homeless situation. Mm-hmm. How did people treat you?
Not very well. No, they really look down upon you. But then there's other people out there that are very kind to you, and it makes all the difference.
What would you say, Jonna, for somebody like me? I'm driving my car, I stop at I-4, and I see at the exit, and I see you on the corner with a sign saying, God bless you, uh-huh. I need money, I have no job. That was you, uh-huh. right?
Yeah.
What should I do?
Even if you have change or anything, something to eat, anything you can give to that person, because you have to realize that you're out there, you're stuck with nothing, yeah. and also you lose everything constantly, because if it rains or yeah. you can't stay in the same place all the time.
So. Start over every single yeah. day. Mm-hmm. How about even just looking you in the eye? And I mean, did
and
that make a difference?
Giving you a smile.
And
yeah.
giving you a smile. Oh my
or
goodness.
Or even saying, God bless you, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. Because yeah. see, a lot of times, Jonna and Daniel, I think a person like me driving my car, I might think, oh, they're going to go buy drugs, or, you know, I can't give them any money because I'm afraid of what they're going to do with the money. So I like, you know, if I have food in the car, I'll often give, you know, a box of Cheez-Its or whatever I happen to have in the car, but I'm reluctant to give money. But there are some people that are out there that are like Jonna and Daniel that are really looking for money to buy food and not to buy drugs, right?
Yeah, or, absolutely. Or even... And on what Jonna said, also the... Just to know, sometimes just a few words of encouragement really make somebody's day, because a lot of the people that are out there flying signs, these are people that were your neighbors. You know, they had jobs, they worked, and through either bad decisions on their part or sometimes just through pure bad luck, like what happened with Jonna, yeah. they end up in a position to where they don't have anything. Mm-hmm. And just to know that there are people out there that are, you know, still can treat you like a human being does a lot to, you know, encourage you to get back on your feet. Mm-hmm. Like the one thing that Eric said about sustainability, that is just so important. But I know when I was on the street, I just felt such a sense of hopelessness. But now, since getting into the STEP program, I see by dealing with them and also from other people in the program that I can actually reintegrate back into the community and make myself useful to society as a whole. Whereas before I didn't think that way. So, you know, please, I'm asking all the viewers, if you do run across somebody out there on the street holding a sign, I mean, you don't have to give them money, but please remember they're human beings. They're our brothers and sisters out there, man. So, you know, just treat them like you got the love of Christ in you.
Wow. That's powerful. I know that one time, Jonna, in the green room, we were talking ahead of time, and you told me that you felt really angry at one point mm-hmm. toward God because you felt like He'd left you.
Yeah, I felt almost like Job, and I asked God, why would you do this to me? Mm-hmm. You know, I questioned Him, and it took me a long time. I started going back to church, and, you know, it took me a long time to grasp that it wasn't God that did this to me, but and now I'm able to accept God's help again. Mm-hmm.
You two are wonderful. Thank you so much for being here with us today. I think you've given a different look for people to consider what that homeless person, what kind of background they're coming from. We're all victims of circumstances. Mm-hmm. Certain circumstances, nothing having to do with you, put you in those positions. I could be next. The viewer mm-hmm. out there listening today could be the next person. Show that person some dignity and respect, like Daniel so beautifully said. Tell them God bless you. Tell them that you love them. Tell them that you're praying for them. Give them some of the change in your car. They're not all bums. At the end of the day, we're all human beings created by God. Eric, I want to give you the last word. What would you say to our viewers today?
I think that we're speaking to two wonderful people that are representative of a huge population in our community, unfortunately one of the largest. And to go back to Daniel saying, if your perspective on people that are the working poor in this community, or even homeless, is the folks that are flying signs, there are about 20,000 stoplights in Central Florida. And even if you put somebody flying a sign at every corner for every one of those stoplights, you'd still have 360,000 people living in poverty.
Wow.
So it's not just them, and it's a huge population of people in this community. And I hope that people viewing this program or learning about this will, if do nothing else, will talk to somebody else about this, because without the discussion in the community, nothing's ever going to happen. This is a hidden problem, and it won't stay hidden forever. And we need to talk about this before we really don't have any other choice and things get way out of control. And I would say now they're out of control as it is.
Well, education is key, and that's one of the reasons we do a program like this, is to make sure our viewers know that there are working poor people out there who are doing their best to make ends meet. And I just thank you, Eric, for what you're doing there at Up Orlando, and you've done a fantastic job that you'll continue, I pray, to do this job for many, many years to come, as you have set such a great example in for us today with Daniel and Jonna, and the way that they're going to be able to lead sustainable, purposeful lives in Christ because of having gone through STEP and because of having happened upon Up Orlando. So I thank you for that. I thank you for having the courage today, Jonna and Daniel,
You're
to come
welcome.
And tell
thank
a little
you.
Bit about your stories for us. Thank you so much. God
thank
bless you.
You.
Continue.
God bless you as well.
Thank you. Continue to do the great work that you're doing. Well, we've got more for you coming up, so stay with us, viewers. Hi, everyone. We are What's Cooking in the Kitchen today with a special treat. We have Kingston Shaw. Hi, Kingston.
Hi.
How you doing?
Good.
You are the son of who? Who's your mom?
Courtney Dawn Shaw.
Courtney Dawn Shaw.
Names. Am I in Ooh. Trouble or what?
We're so glad to have, you know what we love to do, Courtney, thank you for bringing Kingston, because it's so important to be in the kitchen with your family and to have some times together where we cook and we laugh, and we've already been laughing, just getting ready to do the cooking segment
that's
today.
Right. We have a lot of fun, and we have a lot of fun at home in the kitchen.
You do this with both of your kids?
That's the heart of our home, and Kingston, ever since he was really little, he always gets this little step stool, and he just wanted to be my sous chef, and honestly, that's how
Good.
I was with my dad growing up, and
Good.
I really got my passion for cooking from my dad. So we always say my mom, Ma Bear's really spoiled, right? Because Pa Bear does all the cooking.
Yes.
So today we're sharing a recipe actually from my Pa Bear.
Good.
Right, Kingston, and what are we making today?
Maple sausage breakfast casserole.
Sounds like he might have had this before.
This is a staple in our family. So this dish kind of got started, kicked off for Christmas Eve. We do brunch at my parents. And so everybody comes over after worship and we get in our jammies, right?
Right.
And then you just walk in the house and that maple sausage
smells
is like
so
wafting
good.
Through the air.
Yes.
So we're going to go ahead and get started with that right now. So we usually get just the tube of sausage, the Jimmy Dean sausage.
Uh-huh.
It's really easy. You just kind of plop it in there, and then you just want to cook it down till it's in little crumbles. And you want to make sure it's cooked, you know, pretty good. You don't want to burn it, but cook it all the way through.
So it takes about how long for a tube of sausage?
I would say about 10 minutes,
okay.
Slow cooking, because you don't want to burn it too, you know, you don't want to cook it on too high because it could burn. So
now, how is Kingston at doing things where there's a hot stove? Because he's only 8. I know he looks like he's 10 years old.
I know.
But you let him get around
Absolutely.
The hot stove?
I mean, I think, you know, we've learned from a young age, right? Like, don't touch that, and you touch it, and you burn yourself. So we've gotten past that stage.
Okay.
So even Pa Bear let you start cutting using the knife last week, right?
Wow,
I walk in, and he's cutting an onion. Right?
Whoa.
Yeah, a little slice and dice. Yeah, he was pretty confident with it. So what we're going to do next, we want to get any type of white bread. You want to get something that's really soft. And Kingston's going to show you what he likes to do. You take the crust off. Just on the edge, because you want to just use the center of the bread. And this is going to be the base of our casserole. And if you want to help him, you can go ahead and start layering at the bottom. What we do, though, we like to spray it real quick first, so nothing sticks. So any nonstick spray is really good.
And just layer or just put the bread in
just
flat?
Just side by side.
Okay.
And that kind of creates the base of our casserole dish. And you don't want to have the crust in, because then obviously it's going to be a little bit harder to
It's okay. We can just stick it there. It's fine.
Yeah, no worries. We'll put it in the garbage later.
Actually, I know where it's probably going to end up.
In his mouth.
Right here.
No, that was your sister last night, right? We were prepping
and
everything.
And a little bit of me.
Yeah, how do you feed two big boys? You've got a husband who is a voracious eater, I'm sure, as most husbands are. And then you've got this kid who's growing about 2 inches every week,
and
right?
He's a bottomless pit, and daddy is too. We do a lot of grilling in our house. We do a lot of lean protein, a lot of veggies. But, you know, on the weekends, we treat ourselves. We like to do a pancake bar. And we try to use as many healthy ingredients as possible. But we'd like to live it a little, you know?
But, you know, the thing about protein is, Courtney, and I think you've helped me understand this, because I'm not really good about eating a lot of protein, a lot of meat. But that's what keeps you full.
Absolutely.
And that stays with you for a while so that you don't snack and you don't eat other things.
It does. It gives you that energy. And we always say that, you know, protein, it fuels lean muscle. And lean muscle burns fat. So you've got to feed that muscle. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to grab the Livio. This is an alternative to butter that I love because you don't lose the flavor. So what we're going to do is we're going to actually take a little bit right here. And Kingston, it doesn't matter if you get messy. You're going to spread it on the bread. So you just want to hold it down.
I love that. You tell him that. Doesn't matter if you get messy.
You know
good.
My dad
love
is
it.
A messy chef. My mom will tell you. I mean, stuff is flying all over the floor. But the product is phenomenal.
That's
so it's worth the mess. So
good job.
You know, that's how you learn.
That's
you can't do everything perfect the first time. And so you want to butter a little bit of the bread, and it just gives it that good flavor, and then you can salt and pepper that as well.
Okay.
And then what we're going to do next, Barbara, if you want to start whisking the eggs, we're going to do that.
Did I just use a fork?
Yep, you can use a fork. And we're going to do about 8 eggs for this particular recipe, because one of the things you want it to do, you don't put this immediately in the oven. You actually sit it and let it sit in the refrigerator overnight so it can actually rise up. And
really?
Really fluffy like a souffle.
Good. Uh-huh.
So we're going to whisk the eggs in, and that's good, King. We can finish buttering the rest of those later. If you want to pass Miss Barbara, if you want to help pour in some of the heavy whipping cream, we're going to do one more egg. So
because he wants to crack the egg. All right, let's see how you are at cracking
an egg.
Everybody
in our house wants to crack the egg.
Yes,
Kingston. We're working on it. You just don't want to get the shells in.
Good job.
And you do gentle separation.
Nice,
egg drop,
Kingston.
And you can put the shell right there, Beam.
Okay, look at him.
That was pretty good.
8 years old and he can crack an egg. I'm impressed, Kingston.
Impressed
way to go.
So why don't you help Miss Barbara? You're going to pour in about a pint, which is small. It's not even half of this. It's like half of heavy whipping cream. So put it in gentle. So Barbara, you want to keep whisking.
Okay.
And we want to make that nice and fluffy until it's incorporated.
You don't have to use a mixer. You're just going to use a fork or a whisk.
I mean, I think I learned from my granny-itis. You know, use that wrist. That's a good workout.
Yeah, there we go.
Use a whisk too. You don't have to use a fork. So you want to go ahead and get that nice and incorporated. And
then
Kingston will show you the next step.
Okay.
We are going to take a whole diced onion. And Kingston, if you want to grab that, you want to sprinkle it over the bread. You can grab it. Yeah, you can grab the onions.
What about the butter, Mom? We need more butter,
you want to finish
buttering
there? Yeah. Well, this will just be our example. So for time's sake, if you don't want to do that. So what we're going to do is get the onions.
Conscientious. I love that he's conscientious. He knew those pieces of bread weren't buttered.
He's his daddy's boy. Yeah. He's like, don't miss the process, the procedure.
Just put a big glob of butter in each one. Just glob it. Don't even, do each one. There you go. That's the way I cook.
So the onions gives it a lot of great flavor, too. So people like scallions. We go through onions like water in our house.
So what kind of onions do you? Just a white onion?
Just a white onion.
Okay.
Sometimes we use sweet, like Vidalia onions.
That's my favorite.
A great flavor too. We know being from the south, and then you can also use scallions too. Scallions give a great flavor to this breakfast casserole. So that's really good and whisked.
Oh, thank you.
My wrist is about to fall off. I know. So Kingston, now you can officially sprinkle the onions guilt free.
All right, there you go.
The butter is on the bread. So you want to.
So that's about a whole onion that you
use. It is a whole onion, and if you want to do a rough chop, you don't have to mince it real fine. One thing I love about this casserole is that it's more rustic, so it has a lot of texture to it when you bite in. The one that we made that's already prepared that we're going to get out of the oven is actually has mushrooms in it.
Oh, nice.
And my dad loves mushrooms. Sometimes our kids don't care for mushrooms, but in
well,
this
I'm
casserole.
I'm surprised they like onions because my kids don't like onions yet.
Yeah, this guy will eat a raw onion, as I've said before.
I've seen him do that, actually.
I know. So what we're going to do next is actually, and this is a little hot, but we're going to take the sausage and we want to just go ahead and sprinkle it across. and you just want to layer it all the way across the bread and then just spread it out nice and even.
Okay.
And the thing with this, you don't have to put too much fat content or anything, because you've got that, and no salt, extra salt, because you have it from the sausage.
And I'm surprised that this sausage is not fattier, because it's not. I thought you'd be pouring a ton of oil.
Well, you know, one of the things we do is we actually drain it. So for us, because we're a little bit more health conscious, we get
you'd already drained that.
Got it. That was pre-drained. Okay. So if you want to go ahead and, Kingston, you're going to sprinkle some cheese on first.
And
so
then
we'll
the
do
eggs.
A bottom layer of cheese, and then we're going to put the eggs on top.
All right, we only have about 1 minute, so let's do this fast.
Sprinkle away.
Okay.
And we love cheese in our house.
Oh, we do
little
too.
Miss Care Bear loves
that's
cheese.
The protein that we use mostly
in our
house.
I know, you like dairy. House. You're my dairy
girl. I am a definite dairy girl.
All right. So now she's the dairy queen. That's right. Barbara Beck is the dairy queen.
All right, are we ready?
Yep, we're going to
All right, this is our heavy whipping cream and our yummy, yummy eggs.
You just want to spread it across evenly.
Okay.
And then we're going to finish off with a little bit more cheese on top.
And any kind of cheese. This looks like cheddar and Colby.
Cheddar and Colby Jack, which is our favorite. It's got such
like
a great flavor and bite to it.
Right.
So with this, like I said, we're not going to put this immediately in the oven, but if you want to go ahead and take the one out of the oven that's finished, Kingston, we'll put this one in the fridge because this is going to go on overnight to sit. And it's amazing how much it rises up.
Yeah, and I cannot believe how great this smells. Just
I know,
don't touch that,
phenomenal?
Kingston. You won't touch it, right?
So what we want to do, we're a little messy chefs, if you want to grab the plate, Barbara.
Yes.
And we are going to go ahead and scoop you up a bite. And this one has mushrooms in it, like
Ooh, Kingston, will you eat this one?
Yeah.
All right, here's your fork.
Okay, and then the last but not least, if you want to pass the syrup over, we use a maple syrup on top.
I actually thought that was a cup of coffee.
I know,
I'm
we just
glad
drank
I didn't drink
it. For breakfast,
so we're
going
to put a little
Drizzle
bit of this
on top.
Oh boy.
That's a grand finale right there.
Looks good. All right, let's try
it. So we call this leaven from the oven, right?
I love it.
This is our ode to Paw Bear. What do you think, Barbara? Is that good, Kingston?
I could eat that whole thing. All right, I know what I'm doing this Christmas.
I know. You got to add it to your Christmas recipe and your menus. Kingston, could you kick us to break? Can you tell everybody where they can go and get this recipe? Oh,
he's got a mouthful.
He's got a mouthful. Maybe next time.
All right, where are we going to find this recipe?
We got it. We got a couple more bites, and we're going to digest a little.
Okay. For this recipe and more, go to tv45.org.
Awesome, Kingston.
Very good. You'll get the recipe, tv45.org, or our Facebook page. Thank you, Courtney
and
Kingston Shaw, for being here with us today. Delicious. Thanks so much for watching Welcome Home today. You know, the Bible says the poor will always be with us, and that's evident in our world. There are countless scriptures that refer to the poor, mostly that we should remember the poor and tend to their needs. We should be merciful toward the poor, feed the poor, even dine with the poor. I mean, scripture goes on and on about the poor. It even refers to Jesus as poor. 2 Corinthians 8:9 says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that you, through his poverty, might become rich." And that's what we need to realize. We are all poverty-stricken until we know Christ personally. But the good news is that once we do know him, then we're rich. Rich through his love and our position as heirs of eternal life. So let's get back to the poor here on the earth. Even though we will never completely eradicate poverty, nonetheless, we need to be all about doing our part to help with them, the working poor included. There are ways we can serve and give. Just remember, all that we have belongs to God anyway. So give back a portion to the poor because that's what we're called to do. And that's our note of hope for today. Thanks so much for joining us on Welcome Home, and God bless you.